Oh, we know the pain so well. All
I hear you guys now. Hey, I don't know what
right,
happened.
excellent. Yeah, I don't know. We
Yeah.
know your pain. Technical issues is a fucking bitch, like especially when you're live on air, you know.
This is horrible. And my sound guy was supposed to be like, he's top notch. He's so good. He's done this for years. So I was depending on him and I didn't have it sorted out as an alternative. I have a backup for this. So I've learned my lesson. Shoot. Okay. So we are talking today. I thought we'd talk about parental alienation. It's a subject that I've spoken about long before I've experienced it. And it's just a pain that a lot of men and some women have, and causes people grief, a huge amount of grief. And I don't know how to deal with it. I mean, do we pass laws? Do we, make it a crime to alienate another parent? Do we, ostracize people who do this to other parents? Like, or do we just accept it and move on? I don't know.
Yeah. I don't know. I think with parental alienation, it's you know, I don't think most people would really be aware of what it actually is. And the problem with it is there's no kind of unifying, agreed upon definition of what it actually is to begin with. But in simple terms, I think anybody who's gone through any sort of issue where they've been separated from their child, and it's not on good terms, then you are going to experience symptoms of parental alienation. In some countries, it is an actual defense in court where if you can prove that, you know, the child has been alienated from one of the parents, and beyond that, not just the parents, but the entire family, well, then it is recognized as child abuse. I think the problem is once it is recognized, well, then it immediately then becomes a legal defense. And if it gets to that stage, if you weren't already alienated, well, now you will be to some extent. But the particular definition as it stands, or maybe what's agreed upon, is where the child has to be isolated from or alienated from the other parent for a protracted period of time. This will affect men more than women, because I think Irish society and American society are pretty much a pair on this, and Western society that generally, if there is a breakup, that the child will go to the woman. Now, that's all up for change at the moment, as we know, as rights between men and women equalize, and as we in this country plan to essentially eradicate the term woman from our constitution. Well, then there may be, if a positive outcome can come from it, that men would be by right given that same right as women. That may come to pass. But as things stand, women will generally get custody of the children, and the man will be alienated. If not deliberately, just by the circumstance, you're going to be alienated. You don't have that time to be with your family anymore. So you're already alienated in that sense that you're away from your family. Then you have to go through the torture of arranging set times when you can see your child and when you can't see your child. And that's far from ideal either, you know. But it goes beyond that then when people do take a particular gripe, or even go as far as a hatred towards the other partner. And it can be something as simple as extracting money from another person, where children will be used as a tool to get what they want. And that's normally, in my experience, women who will do that simply because they have custody of the child, but it's not limited to women by any stretch of the imagination as well. Men will do it, and both parents do it. And then if it so happens your children are older, maybe preteen or teen, well, then it can obviously be done in differing ways by, you know, disparaging the other parent in front of the child. And that can, you know, it's a deliberate act that somebody takes upon themselves to completely alienate the child from the other parent, where the child essentially wants nothing to do with that parent based on what the other parent has led that child to believe, and then further by their actions of just not agreeing to simple things like custody times for the father to see the child. And then from a non-legal perspective, the woman just may simply not want you in her life at all and doesn't give a fuck about you. She will think, well, the child is safe with me. You, the man, are a spent force, and then you have to fight to get back into your child's life. So none of it is an ideal fucking situation at all. People do experience parental alienation in that sense. It is a real thing. I think if you're unlucky enough to find yourself in that situation where you are looking at it as a legal offence, you're obviously in a world of hurt to begin with. I've been there. You know, hundreds of thousands of men have been there and continue to be there because essentially we can't sort our own shit out between the two parents. And that's the ideal, but of course, being, you know, living in the real world, sometimes that's just not possible. And the best thing you can do for the child is to get away from the other parent. But being a decent human being, you still want to be in your child's life, or you don't. I don't know how somebody could just say, you know, look, I fucking I'm done. Especially if you're already emotionally attached to the child, it's, I think, a cold heart that can turn around and say, okay, well, right, you know, I mean, the child's life, fine, I'm done. I'll just get on with my life the next day. So it's a really fucking complex issue. There's kind of like a thousand issues before you're actually
Yeah.
seeking parental alienation. But there's a lot of mitigating factors. But it is a real thing. It's tricky in Ireland because I think it's recognized in Sweden. You look at the most progressive countries in Europe, that's where you're going to find most of the research done on it and the outcomes of court cases and stuff like that, if that information is available in those countries. But that's where you will find it. In Ireland, it's a relatively new thing. There's one particular professor, again, I think, who has his professorship is in Denmark or something like that, but he's an Irish citizen and he does operate within the Irish system. He's the kind of the go-to guy on it, the expert. But even he, who would, you know, expound the theories, is again very hesitant to actually make the calling and say, yes, this is an actual case of parental alienation. The courts here won't even entertain the word. They put out a guideline to all courts and all from the this from, came from the High Court to all courts throughout the land and all solicitors and barristers who operate within it, specifically not to refer to alienation within the court system, rather to talk about it in terms of estrangement. But within that, within the parental alienation, there's probably, you know, 10 to 15 awful behaviors that parents do in order to either, you know, get back at the other parent, or they may have it in their head that the best thing for the child really is to be away from the other parent. But we can't ever know. And I think that's one of the reasons why the family courts in Ireland are held in camera. There's nothing worse than having to go to a family court because there's an acknowledgement at the beginning that Christ Almighty, what the fuck am I doing here? What choices did I make to lead me here? And it's really the worst position you can be in at that moment. But at the same time, it can also be a point of light, because good can come from it. Justice can be done and can be served. It seems rare, but that's really based on what you bring to the court, because it is a court, you know. So there are scales, and those poor bastards who have to work in there and listen to this shit day in, day out, and I'm sure be doing other things, and they have to weigh that in the balance and then make decisions based on, you know, incomplete information. They've no real interest in what the parent has to say. They only want to hear what the child has to say. So yeah, so parental alienation, I think kind of became popular in the 80s. With you, Ryan, how did you come across? You said you've been looking at it for a couple of years. So I
Well,
imagine you've been in this situation at some stage. Because for me, I only became aware of it when I was actually in the courts or prior to the courts, and you're going through the system and you're talking to people, and that would have been my first time. Maybe, Christ, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago now, maybe something like that. So how do you come to be aware of the concept itself?
I've had a page on Facebook to bring awareness to it since 2015, and it's just Actions Against Parental Alienation. So if you put no spaces in between it, you type facebook.com/actions against parental alienation. I've had that for 9 years. I'm currently experiencing this now for the first time. I wasn't experiencing it when I started that page, but I had seen my father go through it where I saw a very vindictive woman, mother of five children, his ex-wife. He divorced her. She wasn't very faithful to him. It's a story, and I can't corroborate it, but this was the story that he left her because she wasn't very faithful, and he divorced her, and then, started a family with my mother. And for 18, excuse me, 18 tragic years, he was in and out of courts, collections for child support, liens against his property for it. And then the ex-wife would just say terrible things to the children to force them to not want anything to do with him. So any little minor, trespass, anything that he did, anything that he was suspected of doing. And I only found this out when I met most of my sisters at his funeral, most of my sisters that I had never really spoken to. So I met them at my father's funeral, and I heard about all this, that all the stuff that was being said about my father. And while he wasn't a perfect man, and I had my own problems with him, he wasn't the man that they painted him out to be. What they painted him out to be was the words of a very vindictive woman. And so that was around the time that I started this page, I guess, when my father died. It was shortly after that that I started listening to these horrible stories about this man that was a pretty good man in spite of himself and some of his mistakes. He was a pretty good man and a really good father, good friend to me. Later on in life, he was a good friend to me after he quit drinking and stuff. But even when he was drinking, he wasn't the man that they painted him out to be. And so I started that to bring awareness to it. I had some friends die. They killed themselves due to some parental alienation issues, some custody battles. Oh, shit. So I just started that page to bring awareness to it, just to try to save lives of other men, to bring some awareness to the problem and to sort it out, hopefully in a productive way where, like, maybe the courts or the laws could address it. I know in India and Brazil, they have laws against parental alienation, which those two countries I wouldn't think are as progressive as that, but apparently there is some laws against that specific thing, parental alienation. So I was inspired and in hopes to get some laws in place to save many, many parents, mostly men, from killing themselves over this horrible, horrible thing. Sorry, I can't for a minute. You guys want to talk?
Yeah, that's fine. You just let that roll, Ryan. It's all natural. I like to hear about these laws at some point because I'm very skeptical of fixing this issue with laws. There's a lot of gray areas where other people's rights could be trampled upon in the pursuit of protecting other people's rights. And I think it's just a culture thing. India, Brazil, they're very different cultures from us. I think cultures that would facilitate those laws, that they're reflections of the country rather than the laws informing the country's culture. We need to get some emotional intelligence going in Western countries. And the last place that you will find emotional intelligence is in a courtroom. They're not designed for that. It's very hard to convict psychological terrorism, basically, is what it is.
I'm surprised by India as well, but I don't know the circumstances. But there was a
Well,
time a very sorry,
I
go on.
just was looking it up. I could read it to you. So in the article I found, and there's one that I've referenced from before that's a lot more comprehensive, but says parental alienation laws exist in Brazil and India. In Brazil, specific legislation was created in 2010 to address parental alienation. The law aims to identify the practices of parental alienation to promote the importance of parents and children living together. In India, Supreme Court acknowledged the existence of parental alienation in a 2017 judgment. The court emphasized the psychological harm caused by caused to the child and the importance of both parents involved in the child's life. It is important to note that these are not the only countries with laws against parental alienation, as the as abstracts provided do not cover all countries.
Okay. I think going back to what Howard was saying and looking back to Ireland, maybe in the 50s. Sorry, bear me one second. One of my dogs have escaped. Sorry, it's a terrible interruption. I just need to grab a dog by the neck, throw it into a room. Give me 1 minute, okay?
Go for it.
I have four children with my ex-wife, and we've been divorced for 4 years. I haven't once experienced any alienation or any separation like that. I've always had access to all four children, and I never suspected that would be a case with her and I. It's not necessarily that it won't be in the future, but so far we've been pretty copacetic with just being co-parents, even if we don't like each other. She seems to not like me, but she's been adult enough, mature enough to see the value in me in their lives. So I've been blessed to have those four relationships uninterrupted by the other parent. I never suspected I would be in a position where I had this sort of situation where I am now seeing this same thing in my life that my father experienced, where it seems like the mother is upset with me for something I did. And it's something that she did too. She has repeatedly done the same exact thing she's upset with me about. But she's upset with me. And to punish me, at first it was just simple silent treatment. And this is something I looked up in narcissistic abuse. And that's, silent treatment is one of these abusing factors in those kind of relationships. I don't know if that's what I'm identifying, but it's something that I noticed, that the silent treatment is, just a source to harm somebody, manipulate somebody, and control somebody. Oh, you're not going to get what you want. You don't want access. You want access, but you don't get it. You want to talk, you don't get that. You want to see your children, you don't get that, until you do X, Y, and Z. And then it's a controlling factor. Oh, so I don't know. It's like a female covert narcissistic abuse is what it was titled when I looked it up. And I don't know. Maybe silence for a couple weeks is a good thing, but we had just went through a traumatic breakup. It was not a great breakup. It was pretty hard, and there was threats leading up to it that if I asked for joint custody, that I would never be able to speak to the kids again. And that was before we broke up. That was months before we had any sort of a breakup situation. So I was walking on eggshells, knowing that was a possibility. And then that possibility became a reality. it seems like, and now I'm fighting this battle. But you know, there's two factors. There's five children that I love that I can't see and talk to, and there's this friendship that I had developed over 6 years with a person who I adore, which is just as traumatic, and you know, in a lot of ways. So it is really abusive in my opinion. And looking at the statistics of male suicide, I mean, it's very abusive. It's very harmful to the party getting the silent treatment, as far as I can see. And I think that that's a deliberate move to make somebody feel punished, you know, to hurt somebody, I guess. I don't know. It has definitely wrecked my whole world.
Yeah,
Sorry,
we are. Morgan.
Sorry, I'll come to what you've just been saying in a minute. I just wanted to go back to I was saying that looking back to Ireland to the kind of 1950s where divorce in Ireland was a very rare occurrence and it was illegal. I think it was still illegal until the 80s and couples did kind of suffer on because it wasn't accepted within our Irish society to divorce. Generally, it wasn't, you know, there would be quote unquote more enlightened people who, you know, would have been campaigning for divorce at that particular stage. And I think that's what we're kind of suggesting overall, isn't it? That the best case scenario would be one mother, one father, with one family. But we don't do that. So if we want that type of society in the absence of a restrictive practice that prohibits it and shames it, well then it's really going to be upon the individual, which is I haven't met one who can do this yet, mind you, but to make the decision that okay, I've tried it the family thing once, it died on its arse. Now to save anybody any more pain in the future, I'm not doing it again ever. I will still engage in sex. You know, maybe you get a vasectomy, but at that stage, you say to yourself, you take it upon yourself. Well, you know, I've fucked this up, or it's fucked up. Either way, you know, if you find yourself in a fucked up situation, somebody's fucked up somewhere. So then it's a you take it upon yourself to go. Okay, well, I'm not going to engage in it anymore. You're not going to become a celibate, but you're not going to invest in another relationship, because you just had this one chance and now it's gone for whatever reason. But I don't know anyone who can do that because what we tend to do is when one is fucked up, we just move on because we have to, because we're social creatures and then we fall in love again and we make the same mistake and we make the same mistake and we make the same mistake. But at some stage, I think you know I think my marriage is pretty secure. Everybody does until it's not. But at this stage, I think if I was to do it again, I would just fucking I would crumble, you know. And that's part of the problem because you put all this investment in, be it time, energy, emotion, and then to watch it crumble is you know it's tragic. And men do take their lives. Not just because of parental alienation, but they're essentially alienated from society proper, you know, and nobody's coming to fucking help them. Really, nobody, unfortunately, really wants to hear about it. Nobody has a fix for it, and like you said, Howard, I don't think there is a fix for it, especially not within the legal system, because the legal system we have is an adversarial one. So you know, you're already at war going in. Now you know, you've hired mercenaries to help you in your quest, and depending on your treasure chest, will really determine the outcome. Because when you go there, you essentially go there alone if you don't have a legal team. Most people in my circles don't have the money, for a legal team, a solicitor or a barrister. You know, by the end of it, you're out 20, 30,000 euros. And you know, there's no guarantee. Well, you know, there's no solicitor will take you on a, you know, if you win, they only charge you, they'll fucking charge you like through the teeth. And really, you're not going to get that much work done. So that's one solicitor and one barrister. Then if you want to have a, a team and a research team and all that stuff, if you go into the kind of fantasy land of OJ Simpson and, large and Johnny Depp, that kind of money, well, great, you'll have a wonderful chance. But that's just not going to happen in the Irish courts. So, and even with the best will in the world, if they introduce new laws or more updated laws, it's still at the end of the day, if you find yourself in that situation, you're not making the decision. All the control, any small bit of control you had, is now in the hands of other people. And you can only pray that your case is so strong that they can't but, give you custody of the child. But to do it with the argument of parental alienation at a in an Irish court at this time, wouldn't get much traction, especially because Irish courts do put the welfare of the child to the fore. That's what they're really concerned about. Now, obviously, the character of the each parent comes into effect within that. But it's an awful place. So, if to anyone who's listening, if you have any chance of resolving your issues outside of a court setting, I would suggest you do just that. You don't want the battle. If you find yourself, you don't want the war. If you find yourself in that fucking war situation, you're already involved in a battle. But I think the most efficient way to win a battle like this is not to fight at the beginning. You're already in a weak position as a man to begin with. So it's really to, plan your attack, so to speak. Sorry to use it in terms of war, but plan your attack, know the territory, know the lay of the land, know yourself, know the person that you're going there, who that person actually is. And it's going to be difficult. And as a woman, none of us here are women, but we all know there's nothing more precious to a woman than her child. Probably her ego before that, but the child comes a close. Close second.
Absolutely.
But the child, like the trying to, if you take a child from a woman, even if it should be done and everyone agrees with you, it should be done, that woman, that reaction, that loss. I was like, you haven't like lost the life of a child. It's for many ways it's worse, and the shame that comes with it for women to just have a child taken off, forcefully taken off you and given to somebody else. Even if they in their own heart know, like, this child, they may not have a better life, they won't admit to that, but they can know in their heart that this child is safe. If I leave this child with this person, they are safe. And that was my deciding factor when I went through the course for my children. When it became of such importance that they weren't safe, and the opportunity and the right moment had to align, but they kind of align at the same time. And then, when all your ducks are in a row, well, then it's time to make a case, or out of pure desperation. But even then, you don't have to make a case. If there's ever a situation where you're so concerned about your child, kills me to say this, but ring the fucking guards. It's one of those occasions where it's okay to ring the police, is if your children are in danger, ring the fuckers, ring foreign police, Europol, the FBI, anybody, ring them all and tell them there's a terrorist attack. There's something going down at that particular address. And get it sorted that way. But you have to make those decisions coldly, because if there's an issue and you're not in close proximity to take those children, well, then they will by default go into care, maybe for a day or a week or a month, until they, go through the system. And then you've thrown, inadvertently, you've thrown your child into the hands of somebody like Tusla. Again, if I'd rather deal with Tusla or the court system, I'd take the court system any day of the week. For anyone out there in the Irish context, if you're dealing with Tusla, you're dealing with a completely different beast. You're dealing with an organization that presumes you're guilty until you prove otherwise. And that can be tricky, at least with the court system in Ireland. At the moment, you still have the presumption of innocence. Tusla operate on the assumption of guilt. And they go with the premise that that simple premise that you are guilty, and until they prove it otherwise, nothing is going to change.
And
So I think Sorry, sorry to
They
cut
also have a terrible track record of exposing
you.
children in their care to danger of all sorts.
Oh yeah, of all sorts. And this is the state. So we call it Tusla, but it's the state. It's the Irish state. It's the same state that fucking sold babies. But you know, it was under the management of the Catholic Church, so that's okay. You know, it was the priest. It was Jesus. Jesus sold those babies, and Jesus molested those babies. And that's the way it's put forward. But it's not. It's the fucking state. So the Catholic Church, you know, operated as agents for the state, and now it's a mixture of private individuals. And I gotta say, a lot of these guys look like, you know, if your child come home and said, you know, Daddy, can I have a sleepover in, you know, John McNamara's house, I say, is that the John McNamara that works in Tulsa who looks like a fucking rampaging pedophile? No, a lot of them have that fucking look about them. 22 kids are currently missing and from their care, just vanished, you know, somehow magically fucking vanished. So you
Oh, scary.
certainly you don't want that. And that's it. It's all a gamble. When people go to court, you know, unless you're representing yourself, you're not really going to get to say much about your case at all, really, until it's needed, and only when it's needed. But what the courts will push for is for you and the other party to consent to an agreement. That's what they push for. The last thing they want to do is make a ruling on it, because I don't know what their guidelines are when they make rulings. It could be under a certain circumstance where, you know, somebody's halfway around the planet. It's then when the child goes into care or goes into the care of the grandmother or the auntie or uncle or whatever, and then you're none the better for it, you know, as a person. Sorry, Ryan, you were going to say.
I don't even know. I lost my words. I was going to say maybe that in the experience that I've seen with a person, a particular person in Ireland, but you know, ambiguously in general, but like with Tusla being involved, I see the ex of a friend of mine, a female friend of mine, calling everybody, the Garda, Tusla, social welfare, the bank, you know, to try to pay retribution to this friend of mine. And in my case, I was, you know, close to this friend while I was in Ireland, and I actually, you know, she asked me to go to the Garda and let them know that, oh, this guy is harassing me with legal, you know, threats, with all kinds of, you know, state and legal threats, and it's pushing her into a mental crisis. And you know, I like the Garda just laughed at me. They're just like, yeah, whatever. Like, he can do whatever he wants. Like, he was sending the Garda to her house to check on the kids' welfare checks and calling Tusla and calling social welfare, but basically just to harass this woman. And so I was beckoned to go down and speak to the Garda, which I'm fortunate I recorded, because they were so dismissive. They just didn't give a shit that, you know, this guy was harassing her. He's like, the guard that talked to me, he's like, he could call us 3 times a day for a welfare check, and that's not harassment. That's his business. If he wants his children checked on 3 times a day, he can check on them 3 times a day. I was like, man, that seems pretty extreme. Which, you know, when in my situation, I had the local police called on me here first, because I was being ignored. There was a silent treatment, there was alienation. And so I would write her, and she wouldn't respond via one means of communication, so I'd write her in another means of communication. And in all, there was a couple of, you know, there's a couple of electronic messages sent out. She ends up calling the police locally on me, and they just basically told her to kick rocks. They're like, you're co-parenting with this guy, he's the father of your child, he did what? Like, she and you know, there was just all these assumptions that there's things I might do, not things I have done, and that I might do things that hurt her. And they're just like, kick rocks. Like, what are you calling us for? I don't think the police like to get involved in these domestic things, so I think that it.
No, they don't. And there's little they can do. And you know, unless there's a court order, you know, you're never getting a woman kicked out of her own home, you know, or a shared home. It's not going to happen. It will normally be if a woman makes a complaint against a guy, well, then he's out of there straight away. And we can understand that because, you know, generally men, unfortunately for women, the majority of them could easily beat the shit out of the woman. If it comes to that situation, thankfully, to balance that, women currently just have luxury of making a call to the Garda station to say this guy hit me, and you're out the door, you know. And she can go to court the next morning and get an order based on that accusation alone. And I think generally we have to agree to that, because if women didn't have the protection of the law, and I think if men were, you know, true to their nature, let's call it, if men were truly toxic, and did all those terrible things that they try not to do, but they tend to fantasize about sometimes, well, then women might need some level of protection against themselves. But I
You
want to
know
go
what?
back to the, you. Sorry, I
One
want to
thing.
say, sorry, go on.
Right. Oh, I was going to say, it just in the research I did here in the States, it could be different in Ireland, but I doubt it because those women are fierce. But in the States, 40% of domestic abuse comes from women to men. Like they're beating their men here. And then men know that they can't hit her back. Like this has been my case. I've been hit by a woman, can't hit her back. Just have to deal with it. One woman that I was dating just in the last year, like less than a year ago, before I came back to Ireland, actually went to jail for three felonies for beating myself and my daughter, domestic situation. And so I didn't hit her back. Fortunately, I just called up the police dispatch, let them listen to the whole occasion. And I was fortunate to have recorded it. I have a recording thing on my phone, which actually is the thing that got me in trouble in Ireland, is recording things that seem suspicious or seem threatening to me, and I pop on the recorder just so I'm safe. But if I hadn't been on dispatch, or if I hadn't recorded the situation there in Hawaii with this girl that went to jail for three felonies, for hurting myself and my daughter, like all she would have had to say is, "Oh, he hit me. I was defending myself. He hit me." And that's what she tried to do. And then I was like, wait a minute, nope, it's recorded. It's right here, the whole video from start to finish. And the cops just threw her ass in jail. Thank God. But men don't have a lot of recourse. Like if we don't have evidence that we didn't do anything, then it's our word against theirs. And usually, like you say, they call up the Garda, they say this man hit me, take him to jail. They just do. It's her word against his, and then they believe her. We had this big thing in the United States called Believe Women. And it basically was, no matter what, believe women, no matter what, period, just believe them, whatever they say. That was this big push here a couple years ago. And so that's what we deal with. So for men, like I got in major trouble. The only fight that me and this one had in Ireland, the only problem that we had is that I recorded her during one of her tantrums, and it was pretty violent. Like it wasn't like she was hurting me, but it was physical. It was a lot of, just a lot of physical things going on that frightened me and, brought back some memories of what had just happened less than a year ago in Hawaii, where this woman went to jail for three felonies. So I recorded her. At the end, she's like, "Well, why do you make me do this? Or why did you yell in front of my kids? Or why this? Why that? Why was it you that did this?" And I'm like, "Wait, no, wait, wait, wait. I have it recorded. Why was it me? No. Let me play this back for you. Let me play it back and let me expose to you what actually just happened here." And then she's like, "Oh, you recorded me? Get the fuck out of my house." So, I mean, but what else are we supposed to do? Besides record, besides have evidence that, we didn't do what they say we did. But it's so frequent of an accusation and so frequent of a false accusation, that he did this XYZ, therefore take him to jail. And whether it's true or not, that's what happens, is a man goes to jail. I've seen it with my father. I've seen it between my mother and my father. She beat the living shit out of him. She'll admit it. She'll be the first to admit it. Cops get called, he goes to jail. I never seen him lay a hand on her, but I know he went to jail twice for domestic issues after she beat the living shit out of him. So it's like, back then you couldn't just pop out your phone and record, but now you can. But is that, ethical? Is that moral? Is that correct? Or is that a sin? Apparently, according to her and some of her family, me recording her in that situation was a sin, was a major transgression. So I just don't believe it. I don't agree, but that's what they say.
Yeah, well, you mentioned it earlier about Irish women not being emotionally available. That might be a cultural difference. I know American women, and I know Irish women, and American men and Irish men as well. So you may well be onto something there. So the silent treatment can just be a way of avoidance altogether. And you also mentioned that there's the possibility of her being a narcissist, and what you described there sounds like an example of a
could be.
narcissistic rage. But we don't know. Like, so I think everyone goes to that. Like, I fucking, if I'm having issues, I will, go to the, oh, well, they're obviously a fucking narcissist. Because the behavior is there, and that behavior you describe of, being denying it, Darvo, like, so deny, attack, reverse, victim and offender. And so that's a part of it, a narcissist as well. But I think generally most people have narcissistic tendencies. I still have a lot of young children, so they're all fucking narcissists. And so it's kind of inbuilt to begin with. And it's just a matter of do people grow out of it,
Yeah,
I
I think
understand.
you're right about my, I wouldn't want to describe her as like someone with narcissistic behavior disorder. I know there's a difference between having narcissism, like all humans would probably at one time or another have, but and then the whole extreme of narcissistic behavior disorder, behavioral disorder. But I mean, just in the just that narcissists use that tactic. And they use that tactic to control and manipulate. And I think that that tactic gets used, whether it's narcissistic behavioral disorder or whether it's simple narcissism that we all have, or whether it doesn't even need a name. But it's a hurtful and it's an abusive thing to separate a man from his family, especially without good cause. I mean, sure, if he was slapping her around, if there's violence, if there's threats, if he was being overly toxic, if there's something that just was harmful to the family. But like just for simple control mechanism, for a manipulation mechanism, I think it's terrible. It's a terrible hurt. And to expect no like response, like no questions asked, like it seems impossible to just think that the person being put in that position of alienation from his children or silent treatment from the woman, that he would have nothing to say. Nothing at all. And so I think that's like what some expect. I don't see how that could possibly be a normal human response of just, okay, well, I accept this, fine, walk away. That's just not a normal human response, but that's what some expect. Anyway, no, I wouldn't call it any kind of a psychological disorder because I have no clue. I'm inept when it comes to psychology. I don't know much. Anyway, sorry, go ahead with what you were saying. I didn't mean to cut you off there.
No, you're okay, but I'm just saying, like, so if you're describing symptoms of a narcissist or narcissistic behavior, and the general advice is if you're dealing with a narcissist is simply no contact, or as limited contact as is possible with another parent, and even if they're not diagnosed as a narcissist, if there's enough of that behavior there and it's repeated and constant, well, then I think the same rule would probably apply. It's no contact if possible, or as limited contact as is humanly possible. And I know that from experience. But there is, I think, w within women, there definitely is that, let's call it privilege, where you can hit any member of the opposite sex and expect not to be struck back in defense. And if that
Or
rule
any
wasn't
kind of
there,
abuse.
yeah, or if that rule wasn't there, let's just stick with the physical one for a moment. If that rule wasn't there, if it wasn't forbidden to hit a woman, and then I would probably hazard a guess that most men would probably beat the shit out of their women, or give them a beating every now and again if it came to a situation like that where you have been struck, somebody's losing their shit, as again as a defense mechanism. But we don't do that, because there are consequences for it, and it's very difficult to explain away. Well, she was hitting me in the head with a hammer, so I had to slap her in the face. People will still look at you, but come on, it's a woman. Surely you could have just grabbed it from her hand and all that carry on. So I think if those prohibitions weren't there, that women would have a much harder existence. But men might be happier, and I think that comes back to the nature of it, because we're essentially talking about failed relationships between men and women, and there are many reasons. We have our biological needs, we're not really honest. I think when we go into a relationship, what it is we expect, I don't even think we know what it is, what we actually expect when we go into a relationship. It's mostly blind, you know, because it's very hard to sit down with somebody in the when you're in the grip of love and start talking in, you know, utilitarian terms. Well, I require this, 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 and this from a woman, and this. I require this, this, and this from a man. And we live in a very free society, let's be honest, as you know, as oppressive as it is, it's still in many ways, the West is much freer than the rest of the world. In many ways, when it comes to relationships between men and women. But maybe men aren't really suited to it. Maybe that's not a man's nature. What if if a man's nature is what is technically described as toxic masculinity? There'd be none of this situation we talk about now in that type of society. If essentially a woman lives under your rule, under your thumb, and you are the tyrant, let's call it, within the household, there would be no of this issue. There would be no going to court. You know, the woman would know the place within the household. She would have to be subservient to the man. For any man to stand up and promote that today, would be a brave man. But there is, you know, there are belief systems that are more suited to that type of lifestyle, and Islam in particular. I forgot about Mormonism. We talked about it earlier, before the show. I think a lot of men are disaffected with how things stand at the moment. They have no power. The traditional role of a man has been denigrated for so long, and the modern notion is that well, women can just do anything. Women are so fantastic and so amazing that not only can they be great women, but they can be better men than men themselves. And then we also have the state to go along with it. So the traditional needs of a man for protection and to be provide financial support for the family. There's a safety net there of social services, you know. So I think really if it's hard for me to say this, but I think Islam might be a more suited ideology to man's true nature. If he's ever to be happy within a relationship with a woman, and this has to disregard her happiness, because it's going to be something that's selfish, and you're going to have to objectify women and actually treat them as property, like these are mine. And this is currently typified by the attitude of someone like Andrew Tate. And the immediate reaction to it is one of horror and disgust, because who wants a partner as a slave? So there's a disgust and a revulsion to that initially. But I
I
think
would say, I don't mean to cut you off, but like I saw Christopher Hitchens in an interview with the female interviewer. I can't remember what talk show she was hosting, but Christopher Hitchens, you know, very progressive liberal fellow, atheist, not into any religion, hates them all equally. But he said any woman of mine wouldn't have to work, you know, like she and he expanded on it, and he said she could if she wanted to, but you know that's not her role. Like, you know, as gender roles go, as human evolution has gone in what we see in our biology and our you know psychological makeup, you know, just in how we're built, you know, men are the protectors and the providers, women are the nurturers and the homemakers. And so for her to be truly happy in her nature, the way she's built from nature, her nature would lead her to want to nurture and care for a house. So he's saying, as a chivalrous, you know, hopeless romantic, I don't know, someone in tune with the nature of man and mankind, he's saying that if, you know, he's with a woman, she wouldn't have to work, but she could if she wanted to. This woman took such offense as talk show host. She called him sexist. She called him, you know, old-fashioned, traditional, like, you know, antiquated, and, you know, just was very upset with him, very disgusted with him, that he would even imply that he would be the one to work while his woman stayed home, you know. But he didn't mean it that way. He was just saying, you know, if she didn't want to work, she wouldn't have to work. I would provide for her. That's my duty in the relationship. But I think what women are being told in their women's magazines, in their circle of friends, in mainstream society and politics, is that you are basically a man, but you've got a vagina. So you would be happy doing all the things a man does. And if you're not doing all the things a man does, then clearly there's something wrong with you and you're not happy. So then now women want to be the breadwinners, women want to be single parents, women want to do it all themselves, women don't want anything to do with a man, because having a man do the things that they should be doing, that society tells them they should do, reduces their value in the world. So if they're not leading the family, the head of household, and making an income and protecting and providing for the family, then they're not worth anything. That's what society is telling them today. But I think if anybody studied human biology, we know that women are happiest, most women, maybe not all, but women are happiest, and the careers they choose, by and large, that they're not forced to do, but that they choose to do, are roles of nurturing, like caregivers and nurses and things like that, pediatrics and things. That's what women gravitate to in society for work, and that's what they, like in their independent womanhood, their strong independent womanhood, they still go out into the world and submit to usually a man who's their boss and do a role of nurturing, whether it be a nurse or a child caregiver or a school teacher or whatever, but they gravitate towards that. That's what fulfills their inner desires. That's what makes them tick, is nurturing. And so, I mean, all this new, independent, strong womanhood thing that's in our nature now, or in our politics, in our ether, that's all shaming women for complying with their nature, with adopting what they're truly built to do and what they really like to do. They're being told that they're weak if they don't act just like a man. And that's the difference in our society as opposed to 50 years ago, I think.
And again, I think it's hard to know at the best of times what women want, especially if they won't tell you directly. But there has to be still a large section of women out there who don't want that. They just simply don't want the life of children, as fulfilling as it may be, and it is in their nature. It is pretty confining as well. So there has to be, I think, that balance there. Getting modern women to understand that or come to that realization, I think, is a very hard fucking sell. And that's why I'm concerned that maybe, religions like Islam, it would bring order, but the lives of women would be fucking would be absolutely awful, I think, unless they have a penchant to being fond of submission. But again, like,
Well,
can
like
you
I
envision
see.
yourself sitting down with a woman and telling her, a modern woman, and telling her that you want her to be in a position of submission
Well,
to
see, and
you?
I think marriage is that. Like I've told my ex lady in Ireland, hates the idea of marriage, thinks it's just a piece of paper, doesn't like the confines of marriage or whatever, and has mentioned that, like, submission and how she opposes that. And what I'm, I don't think of it as a dirty word. Like if like I said in our last sound test, that marriage is a disposition for men, especially men of means. If a man decides to marry a woman in this fickle society where 50% of marriages end in divorce, he's putting his wealth, his plunder that he's obtained over the years of his life that he's worked hard for, he's putting that on the line like a craps wheel. And whether he wins or loses is up to her. So she can walk away with half, and he could be worth millions, and she walks away with half of that just because she married him, So it's an act of submission on both ends. Like he submits to, all the verbal abuse of, why didn't you fix my car? What's wrong with the dryer? Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you wake the kids up? Why did, and it's an act of submission to him, where he could just be out fucking every girl he meets and being a bachelor and using that wealth to impress people that he could have one night stands with. But he submits to one woman to create a family, to provide and protect for, And he offers that up in a legal document that says if she leaves him, if she just gets tired of him or sees meet somebody with a bigger dick and wants that, you know, she can take half his wealth that she didn't fucking earn, that she had nothing to do with, you know? So like that's an act of submission on both parts. It's not just a tyrannical one-way street. You know, I think it goes both ways.
Yeah, I just think the attraction of a tyrannical rule is there, and for a lot of men, given the uphill battle, I have a sneaking suspicion that they might be happier with that type of Islamic Sharia society. It might be more suited to men's nature. Okay, we're going to stop for some music, maybe a 5 or 10 minute break, and so I can get some liquid. Howard, I don't know if you have anything queued up that we can play, or if
Yes,
you.
I have copyright-friendly music lined up if
Oh,
you
excellent.
don't mind taking a
Yeah.
break, Ryan.
Sure.
All
Let's
right.
do it.
We're going
I'm going to
to
put mine
listen
on
to
mute
the
here.
We're going to listen to the beautiful compositions of Dahi with some beautiful female featured artists. The first here is Carol.
My heart. We both not. Baby, lately, all the love is gone because of you. I've shed the weight of my heart. We both know why we're feeling this way. Locked down, cold, nothing left you to say. Times are tough enough, you're not just afraid. Yeah. It's not me, it's you.
We'll come back for the show in a minute. I hope you're enjoying Dahi. In order, you heard Carol Rowe featuring Elaine Mai. Case Closed featuring Sunita. Crosshair. And now, Love's on Top.
I know you waited. To say what to do.
I love when she's on top.
You can see this working out for you. Holding on to nothing.
You back, Brian?
Yeah, I'm
here.
Back.
I was just making a misogynistic joke. I said, I love when she's on top.
Love's on Top by Dahi. Where did we leave off?
Okay, no.
I can't remember.
Yeah. Anyway, none of us can remember. So nobody's taking notes. So I had the realization, Ryan, that it's not as bleak as it seems. I can only think of, there's only one other group of men who have gone around the world on different continents and had children, and that's usually conquerors and invaders. Mm. So I am of the mind that Islam is indeed the religion for you. You just have to accept that that's who you are. You are the type of man who can travel continents and vast oceans to impregnate the women of the world. So that may be your calling. That may be.
No, I thought that Morgan was the Genghis Khan of Ireland. I would expect that to be your.
No, I'm not. I have to bow to you. You know, I've only done it in the one country. It's a small island at that. I haven't got a roadshow, a traveling roadshow yet. You know, maybe in the future. I haven't the energy for that.
Well, you know, I'll tell you though.
Oh, we lost him?
Yeah, we've lost him, but we I can hear him on the playback. For some reason, I had that on. Don't know how we lost him.
He's muted. His mic is muted.
Yeah.
Anything wrong with it? I would have nothing to.
You're muted, man.
Oh shit!
No idea why.
It was a call coming through. Damn it! Keeps happening. Anyway, I was talking about the systematic, logical method of raising children in a polygamous environment. It just makes sense. Makes sense to have multiple parents hands-on with the children as long as everybody gets along. There isn't jealousy or rage. Of course, there's going to be some of that, but you know, if it's not excessive, it just seems right. And it wouldn't, for me, I wouldn't ever adopt a religion. I left my parents' religion before I was even an adult. I disowned Mormonism long, long, long ago. I had no interest in it. You know, but their polygamy makes sense, and they're not the first to do it. I mean, in human history, like they say, 60,000 years of our DNA shows a polygamous lineage. You know, we've always been polygamous. Our species is a polygamous species, not a polyormous or polyamorous or whatever they fucking call it, you know, where there's, you know, multiple partners for both sex, but where there's one man and many women and many, many children. And that's just how our society, our species has evolved. That's how we should be. That's how we're designed to be. You know, and not misogynistically speaking, but like, you know, if we look at just the private habits of men compared to women in this country, men spend something around $31 billion a year on porn. Women spend about $5 on porn combined, all of them. They don't care about it, but men do. Men are, you know, inclined to seek pleasure or some sort of visual gratification from other women. Women aren't. Women are emotional. So when women mate or cheat or, stray or divorce their husband, it's usually an emotional thing. It's not usually a visual or sexual thing. It's usually they're emotionally neglected or maybe abused, or maybe they just found a dude with a bigger dick, but typically it's an emotional thing. But I think we're
That's
geared
true too,
towards polygamy.
yeah. No, I think for women, there's no attraction for porn, because all they have to do is walk up to a guy and say, hey, you want to star in your own porn movie now? Yeah, sure, no problem. So women have no need for porn because they could get the real thing on demand at any moment in time by simply asking a stranger if they want to fuck them,
Even the ugliest women can do that. Even the most god-awful obese cows with a wart on their face could get sex fairly easily.
And that's what
you're stretching credulity there, Ryan. I've seen
even...
some.
Go on.
Sorry.
Yeah, women have
but
less,
have you
less
actually
no,
ever
so
seen. Have you ever actually seen a genuinely ugly woman? Like, hideous. Like, where the fuck did that come out of? Like, cousins fucking or something.
Yeah.
I have seen the fattest, most obese women, and plenty here to choose from, having like 10 children. And they start out like absolute cows. They're not, they don't just gradually get up there. Like, they start out at 900 pounds. They have belly rolls over their genitals. I don't even know how the guy fits it in there. And they end up with 10 children. I don't know how. And with multiple men. Multiple men will provide this sperm and this pleasure to these women. And I have no idea how that happens.
It's more valuable than diamonds, especially by weight. Like, if you, what's the weight of an average vagina? Does anyone have a guess? Is it, I don't know.
Sell their souls to the devil for that thing.
Yeah. So, I don't know. Weight wise, a pound, a half a kilo, a couple hundred grams. I don't know. But it's very valuable stuff. So much so that the big fucking fat Jabba the Hutt can have 10 children. I couldn't envision myself having fat with someone, or having sex with someone that large and disgusting.
Well, I
looking.
Mean, for me, and I've came across this in my life only it developed in my life, but the, how do I say this? Nice. I better not say this at all. God, no, I better not say that. I'll be crucified.
You'll
But
crucify.
The smell of them, I gotta say, the smell of it, the fat rolls. I don't know if it's that they eke it from their body, or whether they can't wash themselves in those areas. Like, I can't approach it. Like, it, I can't even get close to that. I don't know how some men do it, but somehow they track men to give them children, and they have many children. I've seen it all over this place. This country is full of very fat people, and somehow they breed. I have no idea.
Yeah, well, that tells us a lot about men as well, doesn't it? And the value of pussy. And it always brings me back to Patrice O'Neill, who's, parting words, or some of his last parting words, where that what men need to do is bring the value of pussy down to nothing. And
well,
unfortunately,
robots,
his way of doing
up,
that was
wow.
Through pimpery. Sorry, what'd you say, Ryan?
Oh, sex robots, they're coming.
Literally. Like, will they have that ability? Yeah, you'd never have to ask the question, are you faking an orgasm? Because, every orgasm is a fake orgasm if it's robotic, Maybe there's a Turing test or a whoring test for sex robots.
Ah, lame.
I know, right? But it might, again, that might be, man's actual nature comes to the fore. We feel terrible guilty about making sex robots out of actual women. So we'll use our ingenuity to create these robots. And then we take all that, moral stuff out of the equation, because it's not a person. It's just that it's a thing. Like, it's actually a sex object. But even then, I don't think men would be happy. And we're still the men actively seeking big, fat, fucking things, like Ryan was describing, because that's a thing, isn't it? People have, that's a fetish for people, isn't it? Like really large women.
It is. So I could give you an anecdote, but I would really get crucified for this one. But there's a website called BBW for you or something. BBW for
Yeah, I'm
you
on
in a,
that.
oh yes.
It's an OnlyFans page.
Something where a friend of mine's new husband found three of his wives on.
Oh my God.
And it's all big women, very big women. It's a fetish. It is. Like, I guess there's, I think that's that thing, though, where men choose the lowest common denominator so they can control the women. Like, the women have very little worth and self-esteem, and they find these big fat women that will just get pushed around and do whatever the fuck they want them to do, which isn't my nature.
That's a cynical view. I'm sure that's a factor, but in a lot of these relationships, you will find that it's the woman who's dominant, and some relationships they're quite equal. I think there's a much bigger factor in there where men decide, I haven't got a whole lot going for me, so I'll just go for the lowest value.
Yeah, that's what I see it as. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm cynical. I'm jaded.
Well, it's got to be the fucking market value of the man as well, isn't it? Let's be honest. I can't imagine there's too many millionaires or billionaires, driving at 2 a.m. in the morning looking for some fucking gigantic fat chick. The fuck. So yeah, that's probably what's only available to a certain sector as well. And let's give men our due. We're not completely shallow. So these fat women might actually be interesting women and attractive in other ways that ultimately leads to a sexual relationship as well. But yeah,
That
I
could
don't
be.
think it's most men's ideal at this day and age is of a big fat sloppy stinky.
No,
I don't want to like it's
I
just.
always no, I am proud. I've got a little bit of ego about me. I punch up. I look for very beautiful women or rich women, rich and beautiful women. I mean, I don't look for the lowest common denominator. I look for sassy bitches that can put me in my place. But, I don't need to
Oh,
control them.
okay.
No,
You need to be
it's good for me.
controlled. That's what it
It's
sounds
good for
like.
me. I don't like to be controlled, but I like to meet my match. I don't like to punch down. I don't like, some submissive robot. But most of the women I've dated in my life have been highly intelligent, more intelligent than me in most ways. And then most of them are self-sufficient. They don't need me for finances and gorgeous. Like this one in Ireland, Jesus Christ, practically sold my soul to the devil. She was so fucking beautiful. And that accent, that beautiful, beautiful dialect, I just couldn't
Okay,
help
you're drifting. You're
it.
drifting.
Sorry.
We
I
need some
couldn't help
background
it.
music. We need some fucking fantasy Irish background
Away,
music,
I'll be
like.
right back.
Oh
It's time for a wake
yeah,
break. I'll be right
yeah.
back. Sorry, guys.
Fade away
No.
to an advert for Kleenex tissues.
I was just looking at a
Oh.
picture of her too. Ah, it's terrible. It's tragic, but
Oh my
no, I
God,
punch.
man. What are you
I punch.
doing to yourself?
Yeah,
I'm torturing
you're.
myself. It's my nature. So.
And that's the problem. Men will pay for that kind of treatment as well. There's many of them who would happily pay money for that. Yeah, you got a bad I think.
Yeah.
Sorry,
She's
Harold.
brighter
I
than me.
actually.
She was definitely more intelligent than me in a lot of ways. And I mean, like I like you would say, and maybe you're joking in it, but maybe it's partially how you view me, but like that or people like me, but that I would be better off in Islam because I would like these submissive women that would go for whatever I choose. But I'm telling you, the women that I choose are the most difficult women. They're not easy women. They
Oh
are
no,
the most
I know they're not like
difficult.
that. So I think a lot of men are attracted to that, but the problem with that is it leads to what we spoke about earlier, because if you were attracted to women who are more intelligent than you, are smarter than you, don't need you, for their survival, well then you are, by extension, a temporary thing to them. You're of no real importance. There's no real need they have
Well,
of
like,
you.
I'll give you an example. My ex-wife, she wasn't a person of means monetarily, but she was brilliant, probably close to genius, and could figure out anything, never needed me for anything, like could have lived her life exclusively on her own without any man, any help, anybody. We both told our families to fuck off. We never leaned on anybody our whole marriage for 18 years, but we held on to each other for 18 years. And the stimulation between us that we're both bright people and we're both ambitious and we both like to explore, we're both very curious, like that played a role in how we were attracted to each other. So it wasn't that she needed me or I needed her, but we really enjoyed each other. And if she would have been a dumb bitch or a, you know, an unattractive bitch, I say the word bitch too much, but if she would have been unattractive or unintelligent, it would have fallen apart way quicker. You know, I was fortunate to have a very attractive and very brilliant woman that could handle anything in life, and she was tough as nails. Like there was a time we were in Maine, where it was middle of winter, February, and our Land Rover had some coolant issue, and you know, it was below zero. It was like 5 degrees below zero, not zero Celsius, zero Fahrenheit, which is probably 10 degrees Celsius lower than zero. But she goes out and fixes this Land Rover. She has to make a part for it with gaskets that she created out of a liquid gasket maker. And I mean, she took the whole damn thing apart and put it back together because I was in a wheelchair after a car accident. I couldn't fix it myself. So she goes out and fixes it brilliantly. Like never needed me for a thing. But we did really well together for 18 years. And if she wouldn't have been mentally stimulating or physically stimulating, you know, or curious like me, we would have fallen apart. Instead of after 18 years, it would have been after eight months. We would have just not had anything to do with each other. It would have been too boring. So I always punch up. I couldn't possibly have a whole bunch of submissive Islamic wives, you know, that are boring and do whatever I want. I would fuck him out of the house. There's no fucking way I
But
could put up with
it
it.
doesn't have to be that, you see, because you could have those brilliant women. It's just you get to keep them for longer,
I'm
and
saying.
you get rid of them at your will, and so be it. So it's a complete reversal of power, you know. So
Okay, now you're talking my language. Where do I sign up for this?
I've been looking. Well, I haven't got the address yet, but I think I'm getting closer to the mark, and the mark may be Islam. I say that kind of half jokingly.
I've always been interested in going to Dubai. See, there's rich, sassy women with some intelligence and could possibly swing some polygamy. Might go over there, might check some of that out. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe if you could leave a kid or two over there too, like spread the empire. Howard, you were going to say something. I know it's probably 3 minutes ago. Do you still have the thought in your head, or is it long
Oh,
gone
it's
at this
just
stage?
an anecdote,
All right.
about men paying for to be treated like shit. I personally know a woman who gets paid just to text a man, random insults and just horrible insults, put downs, all sorts. He gets off on it sexually, and that's the limit of her requirements. So
You
yeah.
know that man that owned McAfee antivirus, John McAfee, when he was in Belize, he had three women, and he paid all three of them to shit in his mouth. So he was on a he put them on a hammock, and he would be underneath the hammock while they're swinging in it, and he'd have them defecate in his mouth.
We wonder why women are afraid of men, huh? Fucking hell. Jesus
Afraid of
Christ.
men.
Oh, this is
It
madness.
happens. Oh boy.
Fucking right, it happens. We were talking about the Vince McMahon thing very briefly the other day. And again, another example of a billionaire. Again, who's it's his only goal seems to be to subject and fuck his female wrestlers. And again, it brings me to Andrew Tate as well. Like these guys who are essentially pimping women, you know, and they seem to be very fucking successful at it. So I think, yeah, maybe we're not at that stage in society yet where we can remove all rights from women. Because I think there's a large enough section of men who over fucking butcher them. We seem to be importing them into the country at the moment, which is hilarious as well. But yeah, it's deeply fucking worrying. And say that again. Sorry, he was in his hammock, and he three women
He's a
underneath the hammock, and
billionaire,
he.
right? He was a billionaire, right? He was all kinds of into technology, and he created McAfee antivirus. So he's still world famous. But like he wanted to be shit on in. He wanted his mouth to be covered in shit.
Oh, he wanted to be covered. Okay, yeah. Okay, right. Jesus Christ. I
So he
thought he
had
was
them
shitting
shitting in his mouth.
in his. Oh my God, like that's even fucking worse. But yeah, I suppose it makes sense. Somebody who has that much control in their daily life, and the only thing they're lacking really is to be submissive, you know. Yes or yes or yes or yes or it's boring for someone like that. So it's got to be a case of, okay, well, I'm missing some humiliation in my life, so I need people to shit in my mouth. Yeah. I suppose he is Mr. Antivirus, so he's well protected on that front as well. If someone takes a shit in his mouth, he's got McAfee antiviral software
You
running
seen
on
any of he made commercials after he retired, and he would just like make self-promotional commercials. I think he might have been running for office, but like his commercials were him doing lines of cocaine off of strippers' asses and all this. Yeah, he was just nuts. He went crazy. It was awesome. He's dead
Wasn't he
now.
making bath salts in his mansion in Bolivia or something like that?
Please, like that's what they say. He claimed that it was cures, like medicinal issues, like things he was pulling from the rainforest for curing this, that, or the other. But I think what it boils down to is he was refining cocaine or making bath salts or something. He was a nut job. He was so crazy.
This is the
Rest
wonders
in
of
peace.
life. Yeah. What a fucking hero. Did he commit suicide, or he died under mysterious circumstances as well, didn't he?
Yeah, I believe it was under, I don't know if it was suicide, but I believe it was under mysterious circumstances. I don't know a lot about his death, but I know he was accused of killing his neighbor in Belize.
Oh yeah.
So like something with the dogs, and there was some sort of commotion, some disturbance next door, and he went over there and threatened him a few times, and then one day the guy ended up dead. So
Okay, I
yeah,
think
it
we
was.
covered it on the show at the time, didn't we, Howard? I think you brought it to the show when McAfee was on the run. God bless him. It's
He
the wonder of life. Like one day you're making antiviral software, the next fucking or 30 years later you're on some island in the where was he? The Bahamas or somewhere, making bath
believe.
salts, surrounded by fucking women who you have shit in your mouth. Like the wonders of human existence. Fucking hell.
Did you see when I got back to the United States just recently? I posted a bunch of pictures. So I got me a four-wheel drive truck and I bought me a new gun. Did you see that gun? You would never see anything like that in Ireland unless it was like heavy military, like big shot military people. But we buy those things like they're candy from the candy store here. It's crazy how much freedom we have. I can't imagine what Ireland was in 1916 and what it was for a good 40 years after that, going to what it is now, where they just don't give a shit about those freedoms. But they are. They've given up their independence, like it seems like to me. And that's what makes, I mean, in my mind, that's what makes a free people is the ability to defend yourself. If you're not able to defend yourself and you're at the whim of whatever tyrannical government, or maybe not tyrannical, but potential tyrannical government, then you're not free. Like we live a certain freedom here, and I think that's what makes me feel better. Like I was wrecked when I got back to the United States. I was so heartbroken. God, I cried for like 3 weeks, like every day, all day. I was a mess. And then I bought that gun, and my whole life changed. Realized I'm free again. Holy shit, life is all right. Bought that four-wheel drive truck, started,
Oh, I'm
climbing
sorry.
the mountains with it. It was beautiful. Got a little
Oh,
tear in
just
my eye.
yeah. No, sorry. It sounded like a fucking suicide note there when you said like you were feeling so terrible, and then you got a shotgun. And like it's like, oh, for fuck's sake! Instead of my life, I was expecting my life ended that day. Not much life changed.
Oh God, no, it was such a new beginning. It was so good. No, I want to be in both countries. There's a certain thing I love about Ireland, and that's that simplicity, that innocence, that traditional value system. It's the
I have
sweetness of
no
people.
idea what the fuck you're talking about,
I
Ryan.
don't either. I was just about to say it. Like, I don't
I'm
know where that
sorry.
is. Where
You
is
guys
that in
haven't
a
been to the
thigh?
US.
Like,
Have not been to the US? Because
huh?
there's nothing like that here. Like what you guys have that you take for granted, like people talking to each other on the street, people coming over, what do they call it, ringing up and having tea, like just sweet conversations, silly conversations, taking the piss out of each other, having the crack. That's unique to you guys. It's so sweet. Here we don't have any of that. Like it's very, very rare. I have it. I'm fortunate that I have it because I have a Mormon family. I have Mormon friends, and we gather like that, and we treat each other that way. Like we reflect an Irish culture here, in our culture, in Mormon culture. We're very sweet to each other. We're very hospitable. We have a lot of guests, but most people in the United States do not. We don't. I've lived in every state. I've been to every state. I've lived in most every state, and not many states are like Utah. Not many states are like Ireland. Most people are introverted and self-absorbed and don't give a shit about each other. But in my state where I've grown up, it's different. It's a lot like Ireland. And so when I come back to the US and I end up in a place like Oregon or some other retarded place that they don't give a shit about each other and everybody's on drugs, fentanyl, whatever, dying in the streets, fucking camping on in tents on the side of the road and shit like that, I feel so hollow. I hate it. I can't even stand it. And then I come back to Utah. And I remember what I love about Ireland. Like it is like that here. It really is. It's a sweet place. You guys would probably find it very similar. You'd probably enjoy it a lot where I come from. It's a really sweet place.
Because yeah, we
But
don't see it from that outside perspective, looking in at Ireland. But that's all we're concerned about losing what we have left of that, because it's not too far a projection into the future where Dublin city centre, which is in the process of becoming that very fucking hellscape you described about, tripping over people in tents on the streets, that's happening at pace now in Dublin. So yeah, I suppose we do recognize that that is precious. I don't think we would have thought it kind of unique to Ireland or Irish culture.
oh, it
But
is. In England, it's not even nearly as sweet. In Netherlands, even though it's polite, it's not sweet. It's not hospitable. Like they're very introverted. I've been in a lot of European countries, but nothing is as sweet as Irish culture. Nothing is as hospitable and cute. God, it makes me cry. I'm sorry. Fuck, I miss it there. I miss it in Ireland so much. But you guys would like it where I'm from. It's very similar. It's a cute place. I'm a ball baby, sorry. Ah.
why are you gay?
Why am I gay? I learned this thing. It's called the reach around. It was when I was in prison. No, I'm just kidding. So anyway, I guess
How
we can
long have you
wrap it
had your
up and
finger
we can get
hovering
it
over that?
into. That's one thing I don't see a lot of in Ireland, and I also don't see a lot of that in Utah, is
Gay
well,
people?
I know it's gay people. Yeah, I don't see a lot of gay people. I know it's
Huh.
there. I know there are gay people in Ireland. I don't know if I've ever met one. I don't think I ever have met a gay person in Ireland. And I may have met two or three here in Utah, but in places like Oregon, every other person that you meet is gay or in some sort of a transition, or they use different pronouns or some shit. I don't see that in Ireland. I don't see people using different pronouns. I don't meet a lot of transgender. I may have met one gay person and I didn't know they were gay, but it's not a huge thing in Ireland. It's definitely not a huge
No.
thing here in Utah.
No, not yet, but I think we're in the process. We're generally, I think, 20 years behind what happens in California, probably in other aspects, 10 years what happens in the behind what happens in the UK. And so we see enough of the chaos around us and, the destruction of the community and kind of culture you're talking about. And we as Irish people, we've lost so much. But really, that's what you described as probably of most value that we have left. And so there's a danger that disappears, and a real danger that that will disappear, and in, a shorter time than anybody could have imagined possible. And then it will, I don't even know if that, well, it will live on in tales of how friendly the Irish were. I mean, even if the current Irish people do disappear or become a rare anomaly that people can go and visit in zoos, they might just keep the existing culture and just have it transposed onto people from different parts of the world, because it is a nice culture, but it is a culture of submission. We, culturally have been at the end of empire, so we know what that is, and we know the effects from it. And I think if, in an Irish perspective, you mentioned earlier about Irish women being something along those being fierce people to deal with, and I think we share that in common with our African American brothers and our brothers, fuck the sisters, our African American brothers, where their women lost a lot of the respect they had for their men, because essentially, as a country and collectively and ancestrally, Irish men weren't able to keep their country. They did eventually get it back. Not all of them, but as men at large, we'll take credit for that. And now again, we face this crisis where we can see that the country and we are o under threat, depending on your level of anxiety. That's anything from, a mass invasion by the UN, to just, mere migration and the prospect of having to compete with hundreds of thousands, possibly millions of new people coming into the country, which is very disturbing for a lot of
Especially for a
Irish
small
people.
country, 5 million people, that's the size of some of our cities. We've got cities bigger than your country.
Oh, I know. So we're currently in the midst of two cohorts of people. Let's call it, if we look at it simplistically, those who refer to Ireland as being full, and that Ireland is not full. So the people on the right are the ones who are saying Ireland is full, which essentially means, look, we are a small country. We have a population of 5 million. We can barely look after each other with the kind of services we have. They're at creaking level. We're importing people. Nobody knows what's going on, when it will stop, how many people are coming in. And we'd like some level of order and control over this situation, please, if that's at all possible. And then we have people on the other extreme who are saying that, like you said there, and it is factually true that, Ireland is essentially empty compared to other large cities. But some of us would like to kind of keep it that fucking way, because
I
I don't
don't
want to
blame you.
live in a country of 20 million or 30, 40, 50 million people. But that seems to
Worst
be,
of it is, I think, I just sorry to cut you off, but I think I am in agreement with you, even though I want to be an immigrant. But if you guys have 20 million people that saturate your culture, even if you have plenty of room for them, what happens to that beautiful culture that you guys, everybody in the whole wide world loves so much about you? It just becomes another big city, a big country. It just it's a melting pot all of a sudden. It's not unique. It's not Ireland anymore. It's some other melting pot. So I would agree with those right wingers, a lot of the right wingers on that Ireland is pretty fucking full right now. Should
yeah,
probably
so
change it all.
it's a terrible phrase on both ends, but yeah, it's what Irish people, I think, in general are worried about, that their culture, their way of life is not even slowly disappearing, but it seems to be rapidly
Rapidly.
disappearing. And
It is.
nobody knows what the future holds, but everybody's desperately worried, and it can probably, I think, only, well, it can end in total submission and capitulation by the people of Ireland, where we just go, okay, well, there's nothing we can do. We can't defend ourselves. If we look at it politically, we're talking about a 20 or 30 year battle, or it all goes to fucking hell in a handbasket, and everybody reverts to start killing each other, and there's enough things going on in the world to make that a real prospect. And thankfully, like I said, we can look at the States and learn lessons from it. I don't think there's been any other, well, at least recent history, a melting pot like the United States, and on many levels it doesn't seem to be fucking working. So
Well,
why
even
maybe
in a smaller, more condensed sample, if you look at Hawaii, Only 13% of Hawaii's residents are Polynesian, and the rest are Japanese mostly, and then there's some white people there, but the smallest population are the Polynesian people. And now Hawaii looks like any other state in the United States. There's nothing unique about Hawaii. You've got your oceans and you've got your environment, but the culture is gone. There's nothing left of that cute, sweet Hawaiian culture. It's very, very minimal there. So what people used to go to see and enjoy, and the hospitality that they used to offer, has been replaced by mega, resorts and Hiltons and just very wealthy Japanese people that are basically assholes, for the most part. Very judgmental culture, very acclimated or able to be combined with a Hawaiian culture and not squash it, like it's totally ruined what they used to have, like how open and sweet and traditional and cute they used to be. And now it's just all money. So that's what Ireland will be. They'll just be exploited by the mega resorts, and they'll, parade little leprechauns across the stage for, cute little shows and have some penny whistles playing in the background. It'll be disgusting eventually. That's what I see
That's
what happened to Hawaii anyway.
tragic to hear that about Hawaii. And I'm not going to say that Ireland is that bad, but I think we're at the stage of no return. Definitely. I'm not so worried about Irish culture being diluted because it's dead, it's gone. It's been gone 20, 30 years. Ryan, you may come here as an outsider and think, oh, how quaint. But you weren't here in the 90s, in the 80s, and earlier when I wasn't even around. It's already gone, man. What who's left are just imitations of Irish people, and I include myself in that statement. I'm sorry, but that's just the way it is. So whatever happens from here on out when it comes to influxes of populations, it's just a matter of just try to survive, you know.
Yeah, you're dead right. The pace of change in this country is, I think, what's not known by the outside world. So it's been like a fucking supersonic projectile where Ireland has moved from the traditional values of the last 800 years and then is shot through a fucking cannon almost at light speed into some brave new world. And probably my generation, and probably Howard's as well, and there's not much age difference between the two of us either, but we're probably the last vestiges of that. And I'd be pretty piss poor holding up to the traditions that my own parents used to partake in. But yeah, it's a bleak outlook. So it is essentially it's now going to be a battle for survival
know,
and to
I'll
figure
tell you.
out.
As much as my future was at one time future in-laws, as much as they may or may not like me, they held on to a really cute part of Irish culture. Very hospitable people, had random guests, friends of the family dropping in at any time without notice, coming in and making themselves tea, sitting down at the table, having plenty of time for having the crack, having some chit chat, talking some gossip. And cute, just so cute Christmases and holidays, just the cutest things ever. So when I cry about it, like, I don't know if I got to experience what you guys would have experienced 30 or 40 years ago, but what I experienced was what I experienced as a child with a large family where people came over randomly and just dropped in. And even my grandma, she was a tea drinker, so she'd fix everybody tea, and we would just sit and talk story, to have the crack. We just enjoy ourselves with each other. Not anymore. Like, that's not a thing in our family at all anymore. But like when I go back to Ireland and experience that. I think that's a very Irish thing to do. I think it's so cute. It's so fucking adorable. Like, it really should be protected. It's sad that it's going away. It's really fucking sad.
Yep.
Yeah. But that element, I wouldn't be, that wouldn't bother me now. That dropping in for tea and shit. It's like, get the fuck out. Like, who invited you fucking over? But I'm from the city originally, so that would have been gone in my time anyway. But I'm not that, that's just not my personality type. People dropping in left, right, and center. It's like, you know, it's like, hang on a fucking minute. I'm like, yo, don't you knock before you come in the fucking door.
They
but you're right.
Don't.
That Sorry, say that again.
People at the in-laws, even at my ex's house, there would be two or three at least that come over at my ex's house, and they wouldn't knock. They would walk right in, go straight to the kitchen and make some tea. It was funny. It was annoying to me. I'm very protective and territorial, so I was a little bit put off, but now leaving it and not being there for it, not enjoying what I used to, is heartbreaking. It really is. It actually breaks me to think that I lost that, because it was special. It really was special. It was cute. Yeah. And that is a very unique Irish thing, I think. I think it is, and I don't see it anywhere else. So I've been a lot of places, and I don't see that anywhere else. Maybe here in Utah. And they are not allowed to drink tea. Mormons are forbidden from tea. Tea and coffee are forbidden in our culture.
Yeah, you just get high on hot chocolate.
Hot chocolate, and they own the Pepsi and Coke brands, so a part of them anyway. So you can drink that kind of stuff, but they have these health guidelines, and tea and coffee are forbidden. And they define it as hot drink in their what they call the word of wisdom in the Mormon culture. So if you drink so-called hot drink, which mainly defines tea or coffee, then you lose your temple recommend. You can't go to heaven. God, it's so bizarre.
I've noticed adverts for Mormon missionaries have been coming up in my Facebook feed recently. All women as well, which is a relatively new thing. How long ago was that? A year, 2 years ago? Who fucking knows?
Oh, 2 years ago now. The sisters, yeah.
Yeah, so that Howard was in contact with those two sisters. Maybe these are the same sisters. I think it was Galway as well, where they're advertising. But is that a recent thing? Like, I didn't think female.
21.95 single wash. Sorry, guys, I'm just getting my car washed here.
Really?
Okay.
Still in the middle of the day for me, so I'm still getting things done. Sorry. Okay.
My God.
I didn't know you'd moved from the
No.
What a house.
Just a moment
what a
ago,
house.
But what's that?
I said, what a house. You've got a car wash in that comes to the room you're in. We didn't know you left the room, like, so to hear you go from, you know, I still have you visually in the room you were broadcasting from, and now you're in a car wash. So it's quite it's like, how are you in a fucking car wash? Like, what
I was just thinking, because I had to dig my friend out. Thank you. I had to dig my friend out. I went up the canyon where his sheep farm is, and I had to dig him out. I went up to dig him out, and I got stuck. And then my transmissions all messed up because I was buried in mud. This thing is covered. And so I have to spray off the transmission before this hardens. I just got thinking. So I had an urgency. I had to leave. I'm sorry.
All right. Okay. I completely lost where I was. Anyway, I just heard a price tag, $21.95, something like that. So what the fuck is happening?
Car wash. Fun thing. Right. That was a cheap one. The most expensive one is $44. It's crazy. While we make a lot of money here, we spend a lot. It's crazy how much it is to live here. It's like the cost of it. You guys think, and I hear this from others, maybe not you guys specifically, but from a lot of Irish, that it's cost of living has gone up so much, and you know, the labor, the wages, and social welfare haven't really accommodated for it, and it's stressful. But like, man, inflation has hit us here. It's crazy. Like my parents' house, they bought it in 98, I don't remember what year they bought it in, but in 90 something, they paid $80,000 for them. That's the average out of 700,000.
I'm sorry, we can't hear any of this. Begin again with your parents' house.
Oh, I think, is it the noise from the car wash?
It might
it's
be.
It's probably interference, yeah. The magnetic coils interfering with
yeah.
the
Yeah, it was like enclosure. So I'd say that the cost of living here is crazy. I hear a lot of Irish complaining about it, but I think our inflation has gone up higher than Ireland's. Except for petrol. Petrol there is insane. I don't know if yeah, it's still on. What is it, like 3.5 liters to a gallon? Something like that.
I don't know.
So like a gallon of gas here is $3. And for a gallon of gas in Ireland, you pay upwards of $6, maybe $7. That's the only
I don't know.
Cost of
How many liters are in a gallon again?
I think it's 3.5 by gallon.
All right. So, what's the rate of petrol? What's the cost of petrol? 170 a liter, probably on average. They're thereabouts. Most of it in taxes, of course. Do you know what hasn't changed? But do you know what hasn't been affected by inflation? The price of a prostitute in Ireland. We
really?
Did this is not from you know, I've never slept with a prostitute. I've never had any sort of sexual
truth comes out, the truth comes
contact.
out.
No, there's evidence to back up my claim here. So like I have we recently did a show where we looked at an Irish website called escortireland.ie, and I looked at that. There was a time in my life when I was lonely, but I did consider, you know, using the services of a prostitute. But when I saw the prices, I was like, Jesus fucking Christ, I can't afford that. You know, I'm only a young man. But it was the same price that we looked a couple of weeks ago, and it was the same price. It was on average 150 euros, I think, for half an hour, and 300 euros for an hour. And that was the same. It's got to be what, maybe fucking 25 years ago, and the price hasn't changed at all, which I find fucking amazing.
Well,
so
that
maybe the price of
pussy
has stalled.
That indicates that the price is overinflated anyway. It's kind of like when you come across someone selling a course or some kind of digital thing online, and they're like 85% off for just today, and today is like every fucking day. You know, it tells you that no, the price is really actually closer to this discount than the full price.
Right. Yeah. But then again, with the introduction of fentanyl, I know that blowjobs are going for like $2.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. Well, maybe that's our future.
Superior blowjobs as well. No teeth.
There you go. Nice gummy blowjob.
It's like a luxury blowjob, and it's gone down in price.
You need to get those car wash people in touch with the fentanyl people and the street prostitutes. I'm like, and you know, get them to look at their economic model, and they might fucking learn something. That's ridiculous. €2 for a blowjob, or $2 for a blowjob, and $48 for a car wash. What kind of fucking world is it?
Oh, Christ. That Black and Decker pecker wrecker. I think I'd take the fentanyl chick over the either one. Oh, no. You know, what's funny is that I'm not very promiscuous. It sounds like I am. It sounds like I'm planting seeds all over the world, but I've had less partners than I can count on both hands from the time I was 15 forward. And like for 18 years, I had one partner only. I believe in monogamy. I mean, I've been monogamous. That's who I am as a person. But like, I'm interested in polygamy. It sounds like it's a good system. I don't know.
But again, you have to have the resources to do that. Men, there's only a certain type of men that got to sleep with those women. So you have to figure out what the fuck you do with the rest of them, you know, and if you would actually be one of the rest of them, or if you, you know, are going to be one of those males who has access to all the females. And the harsh truth is, if you don't have it already, well, then, you know, you weren't likely to have it in the past either. And unfortunately, that's fucking 99% of us, you know. So yeah, I think if you're going to do that today, you have to initially have the wealth, and there is that culture of Islam there that allows it for the man of average means, but yeah, you would definitely have to support that amount of people and keep them happy. How anyone could do it is a fucking mystery to me. But you would need, a lot of resources to be able to pull that off, like either
I mean,
that or
I don't
go
even
ahead.
think that would be the hardest part. You have to have the pimp mentality.
Exactly.
Ryan was saying how, oh, if we all kind of get along, that's bullshit. That's not going to happen. You're leaving that up to a throw of the dice. You need to make it happen. You need to basically brainwash the women because they're not going to do it on their own. It's
They
just not
might.
human nature.
Well, did you ever see Sister Wives, that fella that lived here in Utah, actually, and he had five wives, and I don't know how many children, and they made a TV series out of it, but he had all these wives before the series started, and he wasn't amazingly wealthy, but what he did was he made these women, like he worked with these women, not that he forced them, but like, he worked with these women so that they would be successful and make money for their household and be able to hold down their fort. Each of them all had their own homes, and they all lived in the same neighborhood. They all lived within one house of each other, but they all had separate places to live, but they all kind of supported their own households. And then he just kind of went around and serviced them, kind of mediated the whole thing and orchestrated it so that it all worked well. But he
Yeah,
wasn't
a
like
pimp.
this. Yeah, but he wasn't like a bazillionaire. Like he wasn't the one financing it all. He just made
Oh,
the
that's a yeah, that's just
work.
the community of pimps, though, isn't it? Like it's like you've been born into pimpdom, so you don't have to learn it like the average guy, like say someone like an Andrew Tate type figure who is, a pimp and a human trafficker. And he sells
Is he? I don't
courses
know if
on
that
how
was
to
ever
do.
solved.
Well, the
Did
court
he ever?
case is still pending. Like so, I've been kind of boning up on it recently, so all the court documents are available. Obviously, they're in Romanian, but they've been translated to English. So he is being charged. He's trying to put forward a case that he's being charged with kidnapping. There's no evidence of kidnapping. This, that he's so he's been charged with human trafficking. Setting up a criminal enterprise, and I think there's two charges of rape,
Oh,
and
wow.
there may be something else beyond that. And so, of course, every time we see Andrew Tate, it's he's obviously going to defend himself. This is an attack from the Matrix. Apparently, why the Matrix would be concerned about Andrew Tate, but he's presenting himself as this person who's self-made. And because he hasn't capitulated, he hasn't sold his soul to the Illuminati, and he's been able to escape the Matrix. But this is the Matrix coming after him. But what he's forgotten is that there's a 10-year history of this man online. Like there's fucking, reams of evidence that can be used against him. So there's videos of him openly admitting that, one, he is a pimp, two, how he gets the girls, so he uses the lover boy method to get these girls. He has a particular like for 15 to 16-year-old girls,
Jesus.
and
Wow.
he gets guys pay him a fee. So he had his Hustlers University, so he had a PhD degree at his Hustlers University, which is an online university, and the PhD stands for pimps, hoes, and I can't remember what the D stands for, but he's essentially teaching people how to be a pimp and apply his methods. And he openly says that this applies from street level all the way up to his level. So what he does initially is he goes searching for prospective girls on TikTok, gets the girls to fall in love with him. Him and his accomplishments or accomplices get the girls to fall in love with them. So he feeds them essentially bullshit. Yes, we'll get married. You'll come to live with me. You'll be treated as a queen. And then he gets them well, send me a photo or send me a screenshot of you and your bra or something like that. So he's essentially grooming them. And then over time, once they get comfortable, they then try to move them on to OnlyFans, where Andrew and his company have access to the girls' accounts, so they've no admin access, so they don't know how much it is they could be prospectively earning or where the money is going. And human trafficking comes from the fact that he is grooming these girls. They then fly from their original country to locations where Andrew Tate operates, which I think was London, Romania, and some other country in Europe. So he brings the girls to the house, introduces the girls to the house. When the girls get there, they discover that there's other girls there, and they will be sharing quarters with those girls. When the girls arrive there, his bottom bitch, which is his long-term partner, who it transpires that he has been with since she was the age of 15, she's the bottom bitch. So she is in charge of the girls, gets to befriend them. Then the girls slowly discover that the other girls who are there are doing OnlyFans. So the bottom bitch will instruct the other girls who are more seasoned to get these girls used to being around them naked, to see them performing on OnlyFans. And then the Tate brothers would come and visit and essentially coerce them into performing on OnlyFans, where he would take up to 80 to 90% of their earnings and give them the remaining 10%. And unfortunately for him, the two of the girls who came forward with this initially were US citizens, and they managed to contact their parents, but asked their parents not to inform the authorities because they were fearful for their safety. So the parents told them, and these chat logs of their, you know, they've been released from the court files. They contacted the US embassy. And that's when the shit hit the fan for Andrew Tate. So that's what they went to investigate.
So these two girls were kidnapped, or were they...
Not kidnapped, trafficked. Trafficked. So the definition of trafficking, I don't have it with me. But there are five or six conditions for it to be considered trafficking. So there's coercion. You know, there's the moving somebody, even by coercion, from one country to another country to perform in sexual activity, you know. So you don't have to be, you know, holding a gun to her head and say, you know, suck a dick, bitch, or stick a dildo up your ass, or you're going to get it. So this, his method of pimpery is the lover boy method. So these girls fall in love with him. He fucks them, because it's not complete unless you fuck them. He teaches people to have no emotional attachment to them at all. So it's pure fucking sociopathic behavior. And all the while he's teaching young guys who are, you know, aimless and drifting with no real kind of strong male figure in their lives. So this gets presented as this is what it is to be a strong man. So his wealth is largely based around the exploitation of young women. And so while he was in prison...
some sort of sex ring or something. I don't know what it was in Romania. I didn't know that it was young girls, and I didn't know any of that shit. Wow.
Yeah. So there's the girls who came forward. The girls who came forward are older girls, but there is an investigation into underage girls as well, which would be 15 or 16. So that's probably going to be the youngest age, and even beyond that, beyond the actual trafficking. It's the grooming issue as well. Now, his defense, or part of his defense, is that he was involved. He admits he was involved in the webcam business, but that was in 2016 or something like that. But the court documents actually state the counts of the charges, and it goes from 2016 up as far as 2021, I think. So it would have been still in operation at that stage. And he's changed the name of Hustler University. He's changed that to The Real World. I don't know if the pimping stuff is still there. I doubt it. I think you'd want to take that down immediately. Mm-hmm. But his other focus is essentially crypto. And... those websites, you know, those kind of reselling websites where, you know, it links to something like AliExpress, but it's just random web page. I know there's a name for it, but
Drop
it escapes
shipping.
me. Thank you. Yeah,
Oh.
drop shipping and crypto, and yeah, it's an
He's
absolute
selling
clusterfuck.
bullshit ideas. Oh, he's weak. I didn't know
Yeah.
that. I didn't know any of
But
that. I didn't know about Hustler University either. That's funny. So
yeah,
he's
it's all the scummy elements of kind of the men's rights movements and the pickup artists and all that kind of crack, you know. Yeah, so he epitomizes that, and that's with on top of that, there's his, you know, miraculous conversion to Islam,
Yeah,
which
I think that's
just
hilarious.
coincidentally, you know, kind of doesn't really have a problem with any of that on a fundamental level. And there are many references one can go to where, you know, Allah forgives all anyway. So it's kind of okay to carry on in that vein. Yeah. So yeah, I don't think Andrew is innocent, and there's just so much shit he's put out there where he's been proven to be lying through his teeth continuously. Yeah, it doesn't look good, and I don't like the man, but his methods do work. They do
Yeah,
work. They are
they
effective,
seem
and
to
that's the
work.
danger for women, and that's why they should be afraid, because the most and these aren't dummies either. Like, so you know, they're not like some fucking cabbages who, you know, are low IQ. Like, these, a lot of them are beautiful women and intelligent women, but there is that innate desire within a woman to be controlled, to have that man to look to. Even if it means, you know, giving all your fucking wealth to him and letting him have full control of you, there
Well,
is
I'll
that
tell
desire.
you, I think the mentality of women, like looking for a mate, is in that they want somebody that is superior to them. They want somebody that is more capable than them, that's stronger than them, that makes more money than them, that, you know, can move mountains for them. And they want to be the princess, the one taken care of. And, you know, they don't want to be, you know, the showstopper of the relationship. They want, you know, who they've found as a mate to be superior. And I think that women don't punch down, they punch up. They want something better than themselves just by nature. I think that's what they want. And men who exploit that are scumbags, you know, that aren't their hero, but that are their exploiter. Like, those kind of people are absolute scumbags. But I think that's the nature of men and women. You know, women, and same with like age differences. Men typically date younger girls. And, you know, women date older men or whatever, but I think that's the nature of men and women. And I think that's part of that nature, is that women desire something better than themselves, more superior to themselves.
Yeah, I
You
think that's
want
a like
the
good
best
percentage of
hunter.
them.
You don't want the worst hunter, you know, in a you know, hunter-gatherer society. You know, you don't want the mediocre hunter. You want the guy that gets the best hunt, you know, and you know, the best kill, and you know, he takes care of you the best ways, you know, but you don't settle for somebody that is as good at hunting as you are. You know, you want somebody that's far better at hunting than you are. I think that's just how our nature has evolved.
Yeah, but I think the concern is that that system works. We know it works. We know that, you know, tyrannical
Yeah.
rule tends to work on a couple of
Well,
different
I mean,
levels. The
it
question
sounds
is, I
like the
suppose, is it a more would we be happier if we were, you know, true tyrants and actually successful at it? But maybe you have to be a sociopath to pull it off, you know. Maybe you have to be that level of degenerate and then have the will to follow it through as well. I hope not, but
it's weird. Well, as far as Genghis
yeah.
Khan goes, I may find another Irish woman someday. I am
I know
deeply attracted.
you will. I can sense it from you like that. You'll never be done with this shit. You're addicted to it. Like all of
Well,
us.
not only that, but I think even with the abuse this one that I've been through has put me through, and the betrayal and the backstabbing and everything else that I felt like this from this woman, I think I would take her back. I swear to God, I'm so in love with that woman. It's crazy.
Yeah. Just think
I don't know what's
how
wrong.
sweet how sweet would the reunion be?
Oh God, I don't know. I'd be awful, I think. Like,
No, I
looking
don't
at
think
it.
so. Like, you've made up, you've made your peace. And you know, you've talked it through, and now you're going to spend the night together. Like that's got to be some
That's
amazing night
how.
after. Are you still there? We lost, right?
I believe
Okay.
so.
All right. He's being raptured.
It was beautiful. It was so good. And I was like, wow, maybe we actually still have feelings for each other. Maybe we're actually going to get married for real. We had been talking for 2 years about getting married while we were apart. And she was going through mental crisis, this or whatever, hiccup that. But why? Why? He's knocking, isn't he? Oh, sorry. I just showed up at my mom's house. I'm getting in trouble.
I can get him.
I can go down. I was just going to clean out my car first. All right, I'll go get him. Anyway, sorry. I just showed up at my mom's house and there's a crisis. My 40-year-old brother.
All right.
Bad signal.
Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I feel like
Yeah,
that's
we
been
totally
one of
lost you there, man.
Oh shit, where are you at? Can you hear me? Oh good. Anyway, I would think I wouldn't do that relationship again, but it's a dream of mine. I still dream about it. Like, I don't know. I still think about that relationship. I'll probably never stop. Probably for the rest of my life. Loved her so much.
All
And
right.
more so those five kids that I developed a bond with, that they've
Well,
never
that's
called,
different.
they've never called any other man dad. They've only ever called me dad, all five of them. And they have another dad, but he's never been in their life. And I've always been there for them, since they were very young. So, I mean, just that whole family scenario, I don't know. I'm a glutton for punishment, but those kids are special to me. I'll never forget that. It was good.
I'm sure they
Yeah.
are, but you will get over this woman. It's just, it's a sickness and it passes in time. That's all.
Yeah,
Maybe so.
they're the wisest words spoken tonight. Yeah, it does pass. It will pass. You, like you said, you're not just giving up the woman. You know, you're giving up all that goes with it as well. But sometimes it can be for the best.
Well, and the family there, I fell in love with her family before I fell in love with her. So their entire family, there's about 30 of them that show up for Christmas, and we have such a good time. I think that part of it, and then the kids that I all bonded with, and all five of them that at one time or another have called me dad, and the three youngest still do. And then the woman, I felt this. I've never felt like I bonded with anybody, like that before, because we're both deeply traumatized and have all these horrible wounds from our past. And I've never met anybody that's been hurt like that, that I bonded with, that I can identify with. So I couldn't spill the beans and talk to people as bluntly with those topics as I could with her. So we bonded on that level of tragedy and trauma. So I think that's part of it. Trauma bonding. Very toxic. All of it was red flags. I should have known better.
Yeah, for sure. But hey, I know what it's like. I'm wired up the same way myself, and I have to be my own parent, and slap myself on the wrist when I notice that I'm going down that direction, because it's just not good news.
No.
Yeah,
No.
yeah, you're dead right, and it's not something that leaves you. It's not something you recover from. It's a part of who you fucking are. And Howard's dead right. You almost need a parent to guide you through it. But that's just not going to happen. So you have to be your own parent and fucking recognize when you're in it or repeating the same silly mistakes again,
Yeah, truly. True story. Well, gosh, thanks you guys for talking with me. I had another therapy session that I didn't even have to pay for, so I appreciate it.
It's
Well, you know,
called
you need all
having
that money.
friends.
Yeah, you're
You guys
gonna need that
probably
money
should.
for those fucking solicitors and lawyers, let me tell you.
Jesus, you're not kidding.
Yeah, save the money into put it into a fucking court case account, and then after a year, if there's enough money there, fly to another country, accept your mission on this planet, which is to have children on every continent. But just let the woman know in advance, listen, this is who I am. This is my mission. I am here to spread your seed throughout the planet. And like
That's
a
what I
cult
told
leader,
her.
cult. Tell her. Well, then it's on her. If you told her that to
I'm
begin with,
very
then she's no case, fucker.
honest with that. I told my first wife, I said, I want 12. She said she wanted zero. So we ended up with four. And with this one, she actually asked me for the baby to begin with. We started this relationship off with her saying she wants a baby out of this. And I'm like, fuck yeah, let's do that. So I talked to my ex-wife. She's like, sure, yeah, go ahead. So yeah, it worked out. I don't know. Oh, you might want to get in the back. This is a shithole. Sorry, bud.
Yeah,
I
but no,
take it around down here.
that's why you never remain friends with your ex-wife. She gave you terrible advice. She said, "Yeah, go for it." She should have said, "No, breathe, motherfucker. Think about what you're doing." If that was a good ex-wife, but there is no such thing as a good ex-wife. So,
I agree with that. The more I
there
learn, the more I know. Jesus.
go.
Well, hey, you guys, I'm going to let you go. I'm in the middle of
All
all
right.
this rustle and bustle and all this. So, can we do it again? I'd love to talk with you guys. You're so helpful to me. I hope you're helpful to our audience. I think you would be. There's a lot of men struggling and that, don't get fair advice. They get the public opinion of all of this nonsense in Western society, but they don't hear the truth from men because men are scared of their wives. So I think it's good to have people
Yeah,
good
that's
to
true. Do
have
you know what
people to
happened
talk to.
before you go? What happened maybe 25 minutes ago? I got a text message. So next week we'll have a guest on by the name of one Mike, and he was joking with me earlier saying that he could spend an hour with us because his wife gets uncomfortable or starts giving him hassle after an hour or so. He come back to me half an hour ago to say his wife has been on to him since. And she wants to move his time from 8 o'clock to 7:30. And so it's universal. There's bitches running men all over the fucking planet at any
Men
given time.
need you. I'm
Yeah.
telling
And
you guys, men need you.
he thought it was happening today, Howard. One Mike thought he was supposed to be on today, so he's now apologizing for missing the show. But I told him explicitly it's the 8th. It's in the messages that it's the 8th. So he's
Oh
still coming on.
no.
Yeah, he thought it's not
Oh,
the
it would have been
worst.
good to have him on. We could have talked about his wife hassling him, all the mental abuse he's going through.
But you know,
I don't think he's cleared to release that sensitive information.
No, absolutely not. Yeah, I just want to check my fucking message now to make sure I told him it was the 8th. I did.
Yeah, should we let Ryan go though?
Yeah, go, Lord Ryan. Go, enjoy your day. Have a good
All
one.
right.
Hey, thanks, guys. We'll talk to you soon. We'll do it next
Okay.
week, maybe sometime.
All right.
Hopefully.
Take care, man. We'll talk to you then.
All
All
right.
right.
Take care, guys.
Cool.
Take care.
Cool. I'll call you on Skype, by the way.
Okay.
All right. See you guys.
Bye-bye.
Hang up. You too. Cheers.